Good evening. I greet you all in the wonderful and precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
I was expecting a much smaller crowd, so now I'm very nervous. I'd like to thank the Mother and the Father of the house. Thank you for trusting me to share what God has laid upon my heart for this meeting, this evening. Last week, I woke up with these words in my spirit, the Ruach of God. And as I began to inquire of the Lord, what is this about? Because I had already had a word that I was preparing. And I knew that this is what Father wants me to share on. And as I began to inquire of the Lord, as I lay prostrate at my altar, I had this vision. I saw a man laying on the ground, and I couldn't understand why. So when I asked Father, what is this about? He said, this is the position of my church. As Adam laid on the ground, powerless and lifeless, before the breath of God entered him, so is my church. My church is dead to its purpose. Dead to its purpose, why? Because the church is not operating according to the blueprints of heaven. And in order for the church to be effective, especially now, the church needs to operate according to God's design, heaven's design. But before I go into this word, let's establish one thing. The correct pronoun to use when referring to the church is the word she, because the church is the bride of Christ, Christ being the bridegroom. So we have it totally wrong when we say we're going to church. No, we are the church. In the book of Revelation 21, verse 9, it says, then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues came to me and talked with me, saying, come, I will show you the bride, the Lamb's wife. If you can very quickly just turn to your neighbor, look at them. You are looking at the Lamb's wife. You are looking at Christ's bride. You are looking at the church. And now that we've established who the church is, we can continue. But allow me first to set a platform concerning God's eternal purpose for the church. The Apostle Paul wrote concerning the church to the intent that now, in the book of Ephesians 3, verse 10 to 11, to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known to the principalities and powers in the heavenly places according to the eternal purpose which he accomplished in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Anyone to complete? Throat's dry.
Amen.
So to the intent now that the manifold, the vast wisdom of God might be made known by who?
Come
by
on.
The church, by us. To who? To principalities and to powers. Where? In heavenly places.
Amen.
This in heavenly places is where the church is supposed to be functioning. And this is according to the eternal purpose of God, which he had already accomplished in Christ. So God's eternal purpose for the church was to make known the manifold wisdom of God to principalities and powers in heavenly places. That's why Paul says we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against powers, against principalities, against rulers of darkness in this age, and against spiritual hosts of wickedness. That's why the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, because we don't operate according to the earthly realm.
Yes.
Now, I'm not sure if you were all here when to me was ministering about an open heaven, but there's something particularly I want to take out from there. She said this, she said that in our community now, there are many deaths that are happening. Now, we see that the church is ineffective because we are supposed to be at a place where we raise the dead. We look at this as being miracles, but Jesus said that greater works will you
come
do
on.
In my name.
Come on.
These are works that the come church on. Is supposed to be performing.
Come on.
Now, I'm not talking about coming here to this building and cleaning it up and making it look presentable for the meeting that take place. We need to do that. But I'm talking about the works. Where are our works?
Yes.
The way I see it, the sad truth and the sad reality is that the church has mastered one work that Jesus taught, and that is to serve. If you serve at all. But where are the works that the one that is in us said that we will do? Where are the works that we are doing that when the one that is in us performed when he walked this very earth? Where are the blind eyes that now see? Where are the ears, the deaf ears that now hear? Where are the mute that now speak? Where are the lame that now walk? Where are the sick that are now healed? And while we are on the subject of the sick, why has the church put a process in healing? Jesus and the first church, the disciples, when they healed, people were instantly
come
healed.
On.
But the reason why we put a process to healing is because we lack faith, not the person that's sick. Why is there a struggle with the demons to come out of a person?
Come on.
There was no struggle when Jesus and the disciples were casting out demons. In fact, they silenced them and they commanded them to come out.
Come on.
There was no back-chatting from the demons.
Come on.
So why do we feel we have to come to this place? We even to look up, we sweat for one lousy demon, a weak demon, just come out one person.
Come on.
We take about 30 to an hour dealing with one lousy demon. Why? Why? Because we are not operating where we're supposed to be.
Yeah.
In the book of Acts, we read about the seven sons of Sceva, if I'm pronouncing his name right. Now, Paul, the apostle, was well known because God was using him in a very unusual way, where if you took a cloth or a handkerchief to him, he'd either lay his hands or anoint it, and you take it back to the sick and they healed. He was casting out demons, and he was basically operating the way he was supposed to.
Yeah.
And these seven sons of Sceva decided to attempt casting out an evil spirit. So when they came to the person with the evil spirit, they said, "We command you by Jesus whom Paul preaches." Now, the demon or the evil spirit said to them, "Jesus, we know. Paul, we know. You, we don't know." And so the evil spirits overpowered them. Why? They were not recognized in the realm of the spirit.
Come on.
And that's why we got to go through a whole long process of deliverance, because we are not recognized in the realm of the spirit.
Come on. Come on.
The purpose of the church is to operate in the heavenlies and affect change around us, in our homes, in our community, in our cities, in our region, in our country, even going abroad. But as long as we operate in the earthly realm, we will never have dominion and authority and rule over the things of the earth. Instead, these things will rule over us. In the book of Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and 27, we all know. But we read about God wanting to create man, and he created him in his image and his likeness to have dominion over the earth, to have dominion over the birds of the air, the fish in the sea, the little creepy things that crawl on the earth, basically to have dominion. So in this portion of scripture, we read about God's purpose for man to have dominion on the earth. Are we operating from that place? No. In chapter 2 of Genesis, we read about God forming man from the dust of the ground. Now you have man there, but his body is lifeless and it's powerless until the breath of life, until the Ruach of God enters his nostrils. And when the Ruach of God enters his nostrils, he becomes a living being. And when he becomes a living being, then only is he able to operate in God's eternal purpose. Can you turn me to the book of Ezekiel 37? I'm going to read from verse 1 to verse 10. Please don't fall asleep. And it reads as following: the hand of the Lord came upon me and brought me out in the spirit of the Lord. And he set me down in the midst of the valley, and it was full of bones. Then he caused me to pass by them all around, and behold, there were very many in the open valley, and indeed they were very dry. And he said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? So I answered, O Lord God, you know. Again he said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, surely I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. I will put sinews on you and bring flesh upon you, cover you with skin and put breath in you, and you shall live. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied, there was a noise, and suddenly a rattling, and the bones came together, bone by bone. Indeed, as I looked, the sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them over, but there was no breath in them. Also he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus is the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, that they may live. Verse 10, so I prophesied, and as he commanded me, and breath came into them, and they lived, and stood upon their feet, an exceedingly great army. So we read that the Father took Ezekiel into a valley that was full of dry bones, and he asked him, can these bones live? Which is obvious if the Creator, the giver of life, is asking. But the way I see it is that the valley must have been a place where a lot of dead people were, because their bodies decomposed, leaving their bones, their skeletons there. And as Ezekiel prophesied to the bones, as he was commanded, he says that there was a rattling. The bones were coming together, bone by bone. God was going to cause breath to enter the bones, but he showed me that he had to make them whole first. Because what would happen if we had to see skeletons walking the earth as living beings? So he had to put sinews on them first. He had to put flesh on them first, and he had to cover them with skin so that we don't see skeletons, we don't see the bones, we don't see death.
Yeah. Yeah.
We see them now as a whole body. Now, after the sinew and the flesh and the skin covered the bones, Ezekiel had to prophesy to the breath. The body was now whole, but there was still no breath in them. The body came together when the members were correctly placed.
Come on.
The body was now in order, and each member was now in its correct place. The eye where it's supposed to be. The nose where it's supposed to be. The arms where they're supposed to be. Each member was now in its correct place and ready to function in the body. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and verse 12, it says, "For as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ." Let me read that again. "For as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ." So we have one body with many members, different parts. The Ruach of God will come into the member and bring the member to life and order. And when the member is brought to life and the life is in order, the member will function in its correct place in the body. The reason why the body does not function as it should is because the member is incorrectly placed. When the member comes into order, so will the body. When our lives come into order, so will this body.
Come on.
We cannot, why? Because we cannot bring to this body what we do not have in our own life.
Come on.
The body is dysfunctional because the member is not functioning.
Come on.
When the ear decides to function as the nose, and the nose decides to function as the thigh, and the thigh decides to function as the mouth, the member is causing a dysfunction in the body. Early parts of Friday morning, Paul. Father woke me up, and this is what he said to me. He said, "The problem is not the body. The problem is the member. The problem is not K&M. The problem is the member. Because it's not the body that lusts, it's the member. It is not the body that gossips, it's the member. It is not the body that fornicates, it's the member. It is not the body that is prideful, it is the members." And as long as the members, as long as we are out of order, we will not allow the body to function at its full potential. I'm getting ready to close. I want to leave with 10 a day because I know that you forgot. Ezekiel 37, verse 10. "So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath came into them, and they lived and stood upon their feet, an exceedingly great army." I just want to take five words out of this portion of scripture and stood up upon their feet. Please just lay for us. You don't want to do it. So just to give us a more vivid picture after after Ezekiel done everything that God told him to do, and now the bones have come in its great place, and the flesh and the sinew and the skin covered the body. Verse 10 says, so I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath came into them, and they lived and stood upon their feet, an exceedingly great army. So they were laying on the ground, even when the body was put together, it was still on the ground. And once breath entered into the body, they stood up. That was your cue. They stood up. They stood upon their feet. This indicates a change of position. This indicates a change of position. Oof. If we keep hearing God telling us to come up higher,
come on.
If we keep hearing him say, come up higher, then apparently you're too low.
Come on.
Our position now. Father is requiring us to change our position. The church has been down for too long. It's time to change your position. You see, as long as you lay on the ground, you will never be able to crush the head of the serpent. As long as you lay in the ground, you will never be able to trample on scorpions. As long as you lay on the ground, you will never be able to heal the sick, because you yourself need healing. As long as you lay in the ground, you will never be recognized in the realm of the spirit. As long as you lay in the ground, you will never see the things that God wants you to see. That's why you will backbite and gossip and talk about the next person. Because you're too low. Get up. Get up. We've been down for too long. It's time to change our position. This is what God is requiring us to do. To change our position. Can we stand, please? I know that we lose our hands be laid on us. But tonight we're not going to do that. If you want, you can come to cross the altar. But tonight you prophesy. You call the breath of God to enter you so that you can change your position. So that you can become effective in our community. Our community is the way it is, and it will remain that way until the church gets itself together.
Come on.
So everyone, if you are able to, begin to speak in your heavenly language. Begin to speak in into a heavenly language. Begin to speak in your heavenly language. Rikatana moso hundo roboshebe. Rikatana moso hundo roboshe kadara. Rekadebe so hundo roboshe kana mosa.
Salamanda broko delias.
Ruko roboshe kana mosa ha.
Rekadebe
si hundo roboshe kana mosa ha.
Rubrikando dia.
Rikadebe sa
hundo roboshe. Mandara broko do di ala la 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 ya sabra kado do 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 she re kado do 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 she bri ala la 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 ya sanda mi ando do 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 di ala la 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 ya she bri kado do 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 sa ile bri kado do 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 sanda inde re 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 di a shanda do 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 si ala la 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 she inde la 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 ya she le bri kado di ala la 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 ya se le break hold do 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 do
Ruach, 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 Ru